God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Amen, my friends. Quite a few announcements for you this morning, as you can see on the screen behind me, or follow along in your programs as well. First of all, if you're a guest here today, we'd love for you to fill out one of our guest cards. On the opposite side of that are our prayer cards. Just drop those cards off in the offering plate at that time in the service. We'll also be collecting today for Loaves and Fishes, our local food pantry. That's what the fish are in the offering plate. Thank you for your patience in the midst of the updates downstairs with all the construction and new tables and whatnot. Thank you for your patience. Your kindness cannot be overstated. There is youth group tonight, 6:30 to 8 o'clock. Next week we're going to have youth group bowling. Tonight though, youth group 6:30 to 8 o'clock. Meanwhile, our growth groups carry on. Tell someone, we're constantly meeting together, as we will soon be wrapping up right around Thanksgiving or directly after that, and we'll look again towards the new year. But until that point, it's still a good time to at least get an idea of what a growth group looks like if you haven't joined one. Coming up as well, the thank you dinner is this Wednesday night here at the church. If you have not RSVP'd and are coming, please RSVP ASAP. Is that a good way to put it? LOL? Yeah, we'll move on. I'll pretend like I know what I'm talking about. So get that in as soon as possible. If you're thankful and are free Wednesday night, thankful for our first responders and are free, it's a great way to say thank you. And maybe get a meal out of it too. Our Toys for Tots box is downstairs. It's ready for you to bring in your unwrapped gifts for our local kids in need. Also, our RADA sales are occurring in between services. So make sure you see folks if you'd like to find a great, hard-to-find gift for someone. RADA sales in between services. Also, craft group meets Monday night. I can't read my own handwriting this morning. The 19th, there we go. Sign up downstairs outside of the church office. Debbie Amon has an announcement for us.
But there are still a few names. If you guys are able to help, I just want to give you a little bit. We currently have 38 kids that are in out-of-home placement in Mercer County at this time. There's only 5 names left. If you don't get a name and you want to help, you can contact me. I can give you some other ways to help our agency. Unfortunately, the holidays are always a stressful time for our families that we work with, so there could be last minute kids that come into care. So I can also put you on a list for those individuals that come into care right before Christmas. But like I said, if you need anything or have any questions, please contact me. But we just need to be in beginning of December-ish, unwrap the box downstairs. And like I said, if you have any questions, my name and numbers in the directory, so just give me a call.
Thanks, Debbie.
Thanks.
So as Debbie Amon, you're interested in helping with Mercer County foster care, especially for us kids who do not have much coming for Christmas, contact her either in the contact information in the church directory, or we can hook you up at the church office, or, well, do it that way. Thank you, Debbie, again. Friends, there's also a few other things to make notice of as well. Thursday, November 29th, 5:30 p.m. begins our door decorating contest. There's a picture of the door that stole the championship away from me last year. I may have to let that go. We'll find out when the music room downstairs was turned into some sort of gingerbread house. I thought Buddy the Elf outside of my door would win, but I was wrong. Either way, that's coming up November 29th. Just make sure you grab a name off of someone's door downstairs, if you'd like to be a part of that. December 2nd, that Sunday evening at 6 p.m., we will have our kids' Christmas cantata here at the church. So our kids' program will be Sunday night, 6 p.m. here, as our kids show just how much practice and effort they put into the play. Some of our students already have their lines memorized. They've been working on this for months. It should be a great event. So if you're free, December 2nd, 6 p.m. here at the church. And our moment for recognition this morning is to make sure we say thank you to our education team. Wayne Miller served as a teacher for our Bible class for 50 years, 60 years, something incredible like that. And so we have many teachers who have been committed for a long period of time. Wayne stepped down since then, so we're looking for a teacher for that class, as well as our education team is involved with many other things, including Sunday school, as well as Marvelous Mondays, as well as our growth groups. So many things that we have going on here at the church. So we need to say thank you to Hope Roberts, our chairperson, as well as Kathy Griggs and Rochelle Schell, Sandra Rogers and Larry Rogers, as well as Tylen Shane and Jamie Segula and Erica Shane and Leanne Stotsky, Cassidy Pierce and Bob Falla and Jessica Jacob, Marianne McCracken, all of whom help in some way with Marvelous Mondays. Also, we need to say thank you to those who work in our nursery, including Tylen Shane and Jamie Segula, Cassidy Pierce and Megan Reed, Zaylee King, Danielle Martin, as well as Miles Kropchak. And to those who lead growth groups like Denise Orr and Bob Falla, as well as Dick and Linda Carlson, as well as Larry and Sandra Rogers, as well as myself, and saying thank you to those who lead those groups, as well as our up Sunday school teachers for our youth, including April and Doug Edney, as well as Kale Fithian, and also to say thank you to John Corner, who also served as one of our teachers. And finally, we do not want to forget Merle Williman, who every week gets here early to make sure he is our Sunday school usher. Friends, that's our education team. What a great group we have. Also this morning, we want to say thank you, because our list is not extensive. It is not complete. We know that, but we want to say thank you to our veterans who have served in honor of and Veterans Day today. And especially after it's the 100th anniversary, 100th anniversary of the end of the World War I. Armistice Day is today. The war to end all wars did not end all wars. So in this constant struggle for peace, we're reminded today of those, one, who have served from our church in the military. And yet, for those whose names we did not add or forgot to add, please forgive us as we say thank you to those who have served, like Vaughn Long, and Jerry Johnson, and George Babix, and Clifford Hale, and Bob Beck, and Gary Butchie, and John Wyant, and Tucker Harris, and Ken Usel, and Kenny Gaughan, and Bob Roddy, and Joe Hood, and Jack Talon, and Bob Falla, and Kevin O'Neill, and Katie Campbell, and Tom Harris Jr., and Jeremy Grundy, and Al French, and Larry Rogers, and Dick Carlson, and Matt Williman, and Phil Gaughan, and Jim Mitchell, and Dave Cook, and Wayne Miller, and so many who we've forgotten, we didn't know about, for those who are near and dear to your heart. For those of you who did serve, and those of you who were there to support those who served, thank you. Talk about incredible bravery, willing to put your life on the line for someone else. Friends, let's greet one another with the love of Christ. And if you know one of our veterans here, make sure you say thank you.
Morning, official. You take the hand up. Good morning.
Oh, yeah. Nobody gets a
good morning.
Shake your hand. Good morning.
Yeah.
We got to work on Christmas lights yet.
Oh, still?
No, they're done.
Oh, okay.
About 10 of them not working while we plug them in, so I'm going to get that truck over with the pocket. And see if we can get them to come on.
Yeah.
That's the one that's wired directly into the hot wire.
Oh, okay.
And the other one's around a diamond. We test it out. They're all working.
Yeah.
So if you learn how to hot wire, we're hard at it.
Yeah.
Live hot lines, I tell you.
Huh.
Hey, Ross, good morning. What happened?
One place you won't find me on top of a ladder.
Yeah.
Wired into it.
And so, my friends, while we grab our seats and continue to prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Picture to have on the screen, isn't it, with a squirrel trying to climb into a pumpkin? Although, as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship, it made me think of the picture with the squirrel climbing into a pumpkin. It made me think of how in the scriptures it tells us for a private prayer life to enter that prayer closet. So we're not publicly seen showing off. But we live in a culture where, if anything, we often don't need to crawl into a prayer closet. This is not showing off. This is about recognizing who we belong to. So let's stand together for our call to worship. Instead of hiding in a pumpkin, openly declare whose we are. Do not fear what everyone else fears.
The Lord Almighty is the one who regards holy.
The Lord is a holy place, the stone that causes people to stumble.
We will share God's destruction among Jesus' followers.
I will wait for and trust in the Lord. Let us rejoice and sing in the Lord and be glad. So as we sing and rejoice and are glad, friends, let's sing together hymn number 144. Apostles' Creed, we found on page 881. So what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day he rose from the dead, he ascended to heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. My friends, please be seated. It is time for our children's message. And so if our youngest folks would like to come forward, that'd be a great thing. Hey, aren't you here? Morning, Evan. Morning, Caroline. Morning, Adeline. Good morning, Cameron. Do you guys like to share?
No.
Yes. What, Evan, what do you like to share? Anything in particular? No? Okay. Food? You like to share food? Oh, Cameron, I like the way you think. Do you have anything good to share with me? Like Snickers? No? Well, yeah? Oh man, well, a man can dream. Okay. Caroline, anything you'd like to share?
I like to share
toys. You like to share toys? Good for you. How good are you? Because when I was your age, I didn't want to share toys with my sister. No way. So, much better job than I was doing. Well, I've got something here for you to share with everybody. Good? Okay, we're cold beans. Here we go. Now, I've got Rice Krispie Treats and Cheez-Its. I had these last week as well. We have plenty. So go ahead, grab two. Whatever you like, Cameron. Good. Yep, whatever ones you like. Cool. Caroline, Adeline, grab two, whatever you like. Adeline, you like the Rice Krispie Treats? Here we go. We have plenty. Here we go, Adeline. You're welcome, Cameron. But I have a job for you to do. You're welcome, Derek. Evan. It's a tough morning. Here you go, Kevin. All right. Now, here's what I'm going to ask you to do, though. You have two of those. I'm going to ask you to share one with somebody else. You're good to share? Derek, you're like, I don't want to share either one. I find the older I get, in some ways, I don't like sharing as much either. But go ahead, share one, okay? Here's why. One of the great ways to show somebody you love them is to share with them. Jesus even told his disciples just before he went to heaven how important it was to share. And Jesus said in Mark 16, verse 15, he said to them all, go into all the world and share the good news to everyone. What's he mean by the good news? In other words, share the news about Jesus Christ. Now, here's the best way to share. Whatever you have there. If you have Rice Krispie Treat, you want to share that. Hand it to the person to say, this is for you. But especially if you want to talk about Jesus, you say, because Jesus loves you, I want you to have this.
I don't think Adeline wants to share.
That's okay. I'm just happy Adeline's here. Yeah, the older we get, the more this makes more sense for us. That's all right, Caroline. If she eats it all, she's up here. That's good stuff. Or throws around. Whatever works. Okay, so what's your job? You've got two things there. One of them you're going to keep, and one of them you're going to...
Share.
Share.
There we go. So keep one, share one, okay? And if you want to share more than one, I've got plenty right here that you can rifle through, okay? So again, what we're going to do, here's your assignment if you choose to accept it. One of those you're going to keep. And one you're gonna? Bingo. We're out of order, doesn't matter. Let's pray. Father, help us to share, especially this great news about Jesus Christ. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Caroline, Cameron, Adeline, Derek, Evan, you guys were great this morning. That's it. Thank you so much. You can go back. If you guys want to hang out up here, that's great, but it gets to be a little old after a while, I bet. But if you're going to hang out, go for it. I was terrified the camera was going to stay up here. She is a gift. Friends, what would you like to thank God for this morning? What would you like to praise God for who God is? What do we need to be praying for? Mary Ann.
I think we need to pray for all the people with all the fire issues and dealt with
them. Amen.
Yeah, the count was 23 this morning, which people have died.
Wow. And for many of us, it's a distant thing. Karen Wagner, Karen Hutchison, shared this morning that her sister lives, Gloria lives in California, and the breathing issues Gloria has alone have made this terrible. That's just breathing issues for one person, let alone lives lost and houses destroyed. All right, Mary Ann, Bob, thank you. Friends, is there anything else we ought to be praying for, you want to thank God for, or praise God for who God is? Denise. Is that from the wildfires, Denise?
No, that's from here, the
foster kids. Oh, for the foster kids. Thank you. Good morning. I'll be paying attention. I was writing them down so I didn't hear the number this morning. Thank you. Yeah, it's a painful reality how many children, some of whom have moved into teenage years, do not have a home. Thanks, Denise. Friends, is there anything else we ought to be praying for? I'm going to thank God for it, or praise God for who God is. Jessica.
Thank you, God, for all the heroes here on earth that He gave us through our soldiers and everybody that served for our country in the past and today.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Yeah. For those who are willing to serve, and at times those who support it, sometimes it's harder to be that care person than it is to serve. Thanks, Jessica. Cameron.
Thank you for your service in the military. Oh.
Amen, Cameron. Friends, is there anything else you want to thank God for? Praise God for who God is. Then why don't we go to the Word of God? Oh, Zaylee, I'm sorry.
It's our mom and dad's 18th anniversary today.
Did you say 80th?
18th.
I didn't think it was 80th. 18th anniversary. That's impressive, Jared. Yeah. Do we need to say some more impressive for Dawn or no? I'm just joking. We better behave. Because I tell your kids, I'm more fearful of you than I am Dawn. If you know who Dawn is, yeah. Well done. Friends, is there anything else you want to thank God for? Praise God for who God is. Let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending the Prince of Peace, Jesus, as the angels called him when he came to earth, the Prince of Peace. And yet we live in a world which is in desperate need of the Prince of Peace to finally and completely reign. We're as though we're the kids whose parents went out of town and did some things well in so many other ways. The party we had has left a mess. Our world does seem to be hurting. We need the Prince of Peace to finally bring about peace. As we see about squabbling even in Armistice Day celebrations this morning, we need peace. When we see it in our politics and the grumbling, and at times rightfully so, we see we still need peace. When we see with our own neighbors in our neighborhoods, whether it's ourselves and someone else, or our neighbors themselves squabbling, or family relations where family members, brothers and sisters and whatnot do not even speak, we know we need peace. When we see the trouble that have hit our streets, where drugs are so rampant, suicide rates are up. We are in such desperate need of peace. When our police officers, emergency responders, EMTs, and the fire department are so put into harm's way because of the poor choices of others, Father, we see again and again, we need peace. Oh, Jesus, please bring about the peace that you promised. And part of that starts with each and every one of us, Father. Empower us to be your agents of peace wherever we are. At times that means standing up, and at times it means stepping back. Give us the wisdom to know how to act as we pray for peace. We thank you as we've seen your hand at work in our lives, bringing about peace. We thank you for the gift that it is for Dawn and Carrie for 18 years of marriage and four great kids. We thank you, Father, for our heroes who are willing to serve and how you protected so many from our midst. We praise you. We're thanking you, Father, for how you provide. We also ask, Father, that you hear our prayers as we pray for an end to the fires in California and for folks like Gloria, Karen Hutchison Wagner's sister, and health needs, let alone so many kids and families who have lost their homes. We pray for an end. Father, we pray for so many from our own areas, 37 kids in foster care, without homes. Open up doors, Father. We ask for this in Jesus' name. When we read the news, we see how hurt our world is. We can change things wherever we are, and your Spirit enables us to be agents of peace where we are. We also pray for the peace to come, that peace that passes understanding to not just be within our hearts, but in our culture as the Prince of Peace reigns on high. Until that day comes, we cling to you, Father. Until that day comes, give us wisdom in how to act and be agents of peace. Until that day comes, and until that day where we can see the Prince of Peace face to face, we instead enter your realm and speak with you as we pray, as Jesus, the Prince of Peace, taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. A few other things, my notes as well, Father, friends, that didn't enter into that prayer time request. First of all, Alicia, our office administrator, wasn't able to be here in worship this morning. She's battling some sort of a cold, and I was expecting 15 people at the house today, so we'll see what happened. I'm fearful that she has bronchitis, just like Chris and Gregory and her granddaughter Riley seem to have, as they're out where Riley lives. So just be praying for Alicia, little one Chris and Riley. Marianne, good morning.
Good morning. Chapter 9, verses 20 through 19, and 26 through 28. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink. In Damascus there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, "Ananias." "Yes, Lord," he answered. The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight." "Lord," Ananias answered, I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name. But the Lord said to Ananias, go. This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. When he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he really was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. He told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord and that the Lord had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. So Saul stayed with them and moved about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord.
Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let's stand together, whether in spirit or in our physical forms, as we sing together. It's hard to not read quite a bit. And here it's important and valuable to see how the Apostle Paul grew in his faith. We can focus on how Jesus appeared to him, which is miraculous and wonderful and awesome. But did you hear about the people who walked him through faith? And what caught my eye this morning, which if you caught me, I was reading on my phone, checking out how in the three passages in the scriptures, Paul's companions there, or Saul's companions, when he persecuted the church, what happened to them? Two people stood out when we read this morning about how they walked Paul from being Saul, persecutor of the church, into becoming a Christian. Who are the folks in your life who have walked you through in your faith? And who are the folks that God's put into your life that you can show what it is to be a Christian? We're called to share and act. It's not just about mouths, but in how we live as we share and act. So, how can we share and act? Well, as we see throughout the scriptures, we're reminded again and again of how to share and act. Who had an opportunity to memorize those verses that we had for our assignment last week? I love it. Y'all are looking at me like the dog just ate your homework. I saw one or two people raise their hands. For many of us, he gave that assignment. That was for last week. And oops, should have done it. Well, some of the verses really point to how powerful and useful the scriptures are. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17 remind us that all scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, correcting, rebuking, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God, the way I memorized it, or that the person of God is thoroughly equipped for every good work. Or there's Psalm 119:20, which says, my soul is consumed with longing for your word. Wow. Too often I look at the scriptures like, ugh, I've got to read that again? That's why I'm being honest. And yet, when your heart's good with God, you want to read. Or there's Psalm 119:105, which I know at least one of you puts into memory, where thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Or there is Matthew chapter 5:17, where Jesus said these words, Do not think I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. Jesus saying this, I didn't come to get rid of the, our words, Old Testament. I didn't come to get rid of it, I came to fulfill it. Well, there's John chapter 1, beginning with verse 1 through verse 14. Who memorized that one? Y'all are looking at me like I'm loopy. I deserve it. But John chapter 1 puts it this way. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. I skipped the verse up. Through him all things were made. Verse 3, without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of man. The light had shined in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it, or the way we might have it for on our morning readings, light has not overcome, or the darkness has not overcome it. Why do we say that? So much in the scriptures we see about light showing up, that God has appeared, that God created light in the very first day, that God continues to move and work, and that Jesus is even called here in John chapter 1, the light in whom there was life. And life, that was the light of all men. When we heard from Acts chapter 9 today, what appeared all around Paul when he was on the road to Damascus? Light. Everywhere. So bright it sounds like that it caused him this momentary blindness. The way it sounds as though somehow he had snowflakes that were covering his eyes, or maybe shavings from soap, something along those lines that were on his eyes, that he was so blinded that these spiritual cataracts made him unseeingable. That's a terrible word, but you get what I mean. He couldn't see. He's blind. In that moment, everything changed for him. When this man who had been persecuting the church, everything became dark. He thought he was doing things right. Paul is the kind of guy who made sure that he had zeal for the Old Testament. So I'm going to talk about how he had the zeal of Phinehas from the Old Testament. Phinehas, who was so zealous for the Lord, he was willing to kill people in Jesus or in God's name. There's that sense, because even with the Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 7, as he's named Saul, he held the robes for those who killed Stephen, one of the first martyrs of the Christian faith. Held their robes so their robes didn't get dirty while their hands were bloody. That same Paul was there running around throwing Christians into prison, trying to have them killed or thrown out of the synagogues. That doesn't sound so bad. There are days you're probably thinking, when I drone on, you'd love to be thrown out of here, right? This is a whole different ball of wax. In that culture, if you're thrown out of the synagogue, you're thrown out of worship life, financial life, your own family life, your own social life. You're out of town. Your life is cut off. You are now anathema to everyone around you, which means you are dead to me. When Paul did have someone thrown out of the synagogue, this meant that you had now had zero homes. This was not a nice thing he was doing. He thought he was doing the right thing as a zealous Jew, holding on to the Old Testament as though it was the only answer from God. And then on the road to Damascus, everything changed. We heard about this a few weeks ago as we talked about sharing our testimonies. But today we see in Acts chapter 9 how one of the three passages describing how Paul became a Christian, the book of Acts, we see how people entered Paul's life. He became a Christian in a powerful, wonderful way. The folks were there to walk him through. For those of us who are willing to share our faith, at times people will be willing to listen. And at times they won't be. Story goes that a little girl, she loved to hear fairy tales and she loved the Bible stories. She loved them so much. Come on in, Adeline. Thanks, Tyler. Awesome. We good? By the way, when I see Caroline at the preschool when they're leaving and I pretend like I'm a mature adult and go out to see them and say goodbye, I pretend. Caroline is one of the sweetest kids out there, waving and saying hi and then saying, why are you here? We'll move on. So Adeline's back. We have a little kid, maybe around Caroline's age, Adeline's older sister, and she would just love to hear, sorry, that's me moving, that's love to hear the stories about the fairy tales, as well as her Bible stories. Mom and Dad read both of them. One night, Mom was reading to her, And she was reading from Revelation chapter 3, verse 23, where you've seen the picture often. Jesus is knocking at the door. And as Mom read that story about Jesus knocking at the door, she looked at the little girl and said, "What would you say if Jesus was knocking at your door, that he wanted to come into your heart?" And the little girl said, "I say, not by the hairs of my chinny chin chin." We're called to share and act. At times, folks may not want to hear from us. There are other times where, well, multiple attempts are a beautiful thing. Studies indicate that often people have heard the gospel 7 times before they say yes to Jesus. 7. I need 2 hands for that number. One story puts it this way. The Reuben Donnelly Company was the largest magazine printer in the United States. And the machine printed, oh boy. Merle, I don't know what I did. I'll get loud. I'm sorry. I didn't turn it off, though. Thanks, Merle. You rock. So, we've got the Reuben Donnelly Company. It was the largest U.S. magazine printer in the United States. And their subscription list was incredible. And one of the things they did was make sure that huge machine that printed off subscription notices, you've received them from magazines, I'll bet. Those subscription renewal notices, well, one day at the Reuben Donnelly Company, it was stuck. The machine was stuck with the same person's name. One Colorado rancher received 9,734 renewal notices for one magazine. Guess what? He sent the check in, and all it said there in the memo line was this: "I give up." Sometimes it just takes multiple times sharing our faith for somebody to hear. Share and act. And there are times as well, no matter how much sharing you do, if you don't do it with love, you're shoving, not sharing. For Tina and I, we used to receive a magazine for America's Test Kitchen. Loved the TV show on PBS. I don't even like watching Food Channel shows. They bore me, honestly. But I'm married, and when my wife watches those shows, delicacies suddenly appear at times. I'm willing to undergo 30 minutes of not so enjoyable TV viewing for what may come out of the kitchen. But this show is worth watching. Problem was, their magazine, as great as it was frustrating by their subscription renewal tactics. We started to receive renewal notices before the first magazine showed up. We started to get phone calls. I don't even know if we gave them our phone number, but they searched it out. We started to receive notices that if we didn't subscribe, we were in trouble, or get this brand new free thing, which we didn't want. To the point where we started writing on the magazine, not just the renewal notices, but the magazine refused. So it charged the PBS-based company postage for it to be returned, because it wouldn't stop. As far as we could tell, they even tried to charge us through our checking account when we didn't want to have it renewed. Why do I say that? That's shoving, not sharing. It's one thing to share about what you believe with someone else, but you know the kind of folks that may shove their beliefs on you. Friends, as Christians, we're not called to shove, we're called to share. There's a moment, one out of maybe 100 times, where God's calling you to shove faith at someone else, to share when they don't want to hear. But often shoving is not the right way to go. We're called to share and act. Part of that sharing is actually telling folks about Jesus Christ. But acting is also about how do you live out life as a Christian. It's not so easy. There are times where it's frustrating. In the church, we call it mentoring, where you're willing to guide folks in how to be a Christian. The story goes like this. A teacher asked all the kids what they wanted to be when they grew up. You know how it goes. One said president, one said a teacher, one said a doctor, one said a fireman. The teacher looked at Billy when he wanted to be when he grew up, and Billy said, "Possible." "What?" asked the teacher. "What do you want to be, Billy?" "I want to be possible." "What are you talking about, Billy?" "Well, my mom says right now I'm impossible. So when I grow up, I'm going to be possible." Everything changes when we become a Christian. There is the Apostle Paul, who was named Saul whenever he was attacking all the Christians. Possibly named after King Saul, who was then deposed in favor of David to be king of Israel, way back in the Old Testament in 1 Samuel. There's Saul, who becomes Paul. Everything for him changed. Man who persecuted the church, who attacked Christians, who helped have Christians murdered, everything changed when he met Jesus. His name changed, his occupation changed, his lifestyle changed. He stopped attacking the church. He instead started to share about Jesus. But there are two people who were involved in his life, as we heard about in Acts 9. First of all, there's Ananias, the one who was there praying by himself, and suddenly God spoke to Ananias when he was praying, said, go to Saul. He is now my chosen person. What? May have been what Saul said. This guy kills Christians. You want me to do what? This man's attacking the church. You want me to do what? God, are you nuts? What? What do you do? Well, Ananias finally caved in and went to Paul, prayed for him, told him that he was God's chosen person, and even put his hand on his forehead, indicating this sort of hint that Saul, who would soon become Paul, just like David was anointed to be king, that suddenly Ananias prayed for Paul. What's fascinating is Ananias then disappears. There is no record of Ananias after Acts 9. You read about a different Ananias in Acts chapter 5 who lied about how he gave a church. You don't want to do that. If you want to find out, read chapter 5. Ananias and Sapphira didn't come back. But in Acts chapter 9, a different Ananias went, listened to God, and ushered in Paul to the faith. Almost as though if you and I get that opportunity to share Jesus with someone else and they accept Christ for themselves. That's what Ananias got to do. But then we hear about Barnabas. And Barnabas is this incredible, powerful man in the scriptures. Barnabas mentored Paul. He was the man who discipled, for lack of a better term, Paul to be a Christian. Barnabas was the one who opened up doors for Paul. He took him to the other leaders of the Jewish faith, who were terrified of Paul, this Christian murderer, or murderer of Christians, I should say. And suddenly, the doors open, and they realized that there's something right with Paul. Barnabas took a chance. He walked with Paul. And then we see that they traveled together in the missionary journeys in Acts chapter 11 and 12 and 13 and Acts 14 and Acts 15. They were, for lack of a better term, brothers. And yet a squabble broke out. They argued about Mark, one of the men who was also a protege of Barnabas. They argued about Mark because Mark was found to be less than reliable. And Paul said, we can't take Mark with us. He's no good. And Barnabas replied, let's take Mark. He's okay. And Paul said, no way. And Barnabas said, yes way. No way. Yes way. You know how this goes. They finally split up. Barnabas took Mark. They went on one route. And then Paul took other folks with him. I forget exactly who he took with him at this point, but I do know in Acts 15 and following, Paul took many different folks, including Silas, as well as Titus, as well as Timothy. And if you look at your Bibles, books were written with letters by the Apostle Paul written to Titus and Timothy, including the one we just heard from this morning. All scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, correcting, rebuking, and training in righteousness, so that the person of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. In other words, something changed in Paul. A man who attacked Christians was suddenly saying, there's good here. They finally do sound like they made up. Paul at one point even mentions that Mark was back in the fold and was a good worker for the Lord. We don't know much more what happened with Barnabas after that. We do hear about the Apostle Paul a lot. But the point for today is this. They walked Paul through the faith. Who's that person in your life? Your assignment now, in the midst of worship, is this. Get into groups of anywhere from 2 to 6. Talk about the person who mentored you in the faith. My guess would be it's not going to be a pastor. That's my guess. I mean, it might be, but my guess is it's not going to be. Who's that person who really walked you through the faith? If it's more than one, then mention more than one, but say why they're noteworthy. Now, in my case, I've got a few here that I need to mention. I mentioned them in the year 2016, but I'll repeat them again. Those who were my mentors in the faith, from youth group as a kid, is Dave Brewer, who was the pastor, associate pastor of the church I grew up in. Dave Brewer, I remember watching often a youth group, and his Lee jeans would start sliding down, so he'd be hiking them up from the boot belt. Boot loops? What am I saying? Boot loops? No, belt loops. Yanking up his pants. Guess who caught himself multiple times as a youth minister yanking his blue jeans up by the belt loops? I also learned from Dave Brewer how to put together a team. From Bob Arnold, who as a kid was my hero in the faith, and as a young teenager. Also others like Lori Wolfe and Gary Schultz when I was in high school. Gary's the one who, whenever I was arrested as a teenager, he's the one who I talked to and really worked that out with. Jim Puglisi and Scott Fleming when I was in college. Bob Mathias, the first pastor I worked for, as well as other folks like Harley Wheeler and Shelley Reimer, a great spiritual director, Rich Vitale, two pastors from the Waltham area who mentored Tina and I, Dick Allen and Bill McGarry, both have gone on to glory. And then ultimately, my wife Tina, who are the folks who helped mentor you in the faith? So, that's your assignment now. You've got a few minutes. Get in the groups of anywhere to 2 to 6. Share who that person is and why. You got it. So my friends, one more minute. If you haven't had a chance to share, make sure you share. And ultimately, if somebody had to say something like, I'm happy to be here, I'm not comfortable sharing, that's fine too. First Peter chapter 5 puts it this way. To the elders among you, in other words, those who are leaders in the church, I appeal to you as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings, who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that's under your care, watching over them. Not because you must, but because you're willing, as God wants you to be. Not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but by being examples to the flock. What's that mean? If you're willing to model it as a Christian, be a shepherd. Someone who leads, someone who cares for, not somebody who forces. And if you'll notice, if you ever work with sheep, it's not like they toe the line perfectly. Same thing with each and every person. But guide them. Be eager to serve. And a line especially jumped out of me be an example to the flock. So much of me becoming a Christian wasn't hearing words from someone else. It was seeing how they lived. Tell someone has, puts it this way on page 110, to disciple someone or coach them in the faith, you just need to be a friend. You need to model what a follower of Jesus Christ looks like in the real world. You want to help them grow spiritually. But how do you do that? Well, Ananias made sure that he prayed for Paul, that he set apart. So it would be praying for other folks, especially those that are on your heart to grow in their faith, or folks that you're guiding. It's also introducing them to other people. Barnabas made sure the door was open to Paul, which might mean take them to church. And if they're not comfortable here, get them someplace where they're comfortable. It's taking them to different spots, whether it's a growth group or a Sunday school or whatnot. So much of it is just living life with them. That might be, here's how you read the Bible. Opening up and starting to read from the book of the Song of Songs or Song of Solomon, or somebody opening up to the book of Revelation to start off with, might be a bit of a stretch. How do you read this Bible? How do you pray? Which is pretty simple according to Jesus. Oh, oh my goodness, I just wanted to start singing. Oh Lord my God. What song am I about to sing? How great thou art. That is not, wow. I can't even pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven. In the first service, I started to pray the Lord's Prayer by saying, the Lord is our shepherd, I shall not be in want. Wowzers, my goodness. So moving on, I need some help too. I show them how to pray. Show them how to read, you know, if you do devotions, how do you do devotions daily? If you don't do devotions daily, that's a place to keep on growing. There are so many ways, but it's just walking through life with someone. For some of you, you've done it. You've done this. They're called your kids. As hard as that is, it's modeling. How do you do this whole following Jesus thing? For me, it's not been kids, but I've seen a lot of kids grow up in youth group and go and start serving in church. Some are in ministry, and some have really just made some stupid, terrible choices. But it's really about loving God in the midst of it. We're called to share an act. The Apostle Paul had Barnabas and had Ananias that we read about. The men who were with Paul on the road to Damascus disappeared. Who are you going to be? God has put people into your life to show how to be a Christian. Friends, if you're not a Christian yet, this doesn't have to count. This doesn't apply to you today. Just say thank you for the message. I had a couple laughs. That was nice. Or, boy, this is strange. But otherwise, friends, who's God put there for you? It's showing how to be a Christian. It's about sharing and acting. Share and act. That's what we're called to do. Amen. I encourage you to pray along with me. If you would, close your eyes and turn your hands up toward heaven as we talk with God and as we pray. Lord God, loving Father.
Lord God, loving Father.
I love you.
I love you.
I was lost and am now found.
I am lost and am now found.
Show me the lost around me.
Show me the lost around me.
Give me the words to share.
Give me the words to share.
Give me the courage to share.
Give me the courage to share.
Give me the ear to share.
Give me the ear to share.
Give me the opportunity to share. Empower me to disciple others.
I pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Friends, let's continue to worship through the giving of our tithes and our offerings. Thank you. Father, we thank you so much for how you bless us and care for us, how you provide for us. We give these gifts back to you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So, my friends, let's continue to worship as we sing together. Fairest Lord Jesus. Fairest Lord Jesus. Hymn number 189.
Peace. Amen. Amen.